Hello everyone and welcome back. We were discussing about enzyme reactors. We were considering the ideal cases, and we have discussed about the ideal batch operation of a well mixed reactor. Now today we will discuss about the continuous operation. Now continuous operation is very attractive, and it is very much used, and for in case of enzymes also it has been used. But for using it with free enzymes, it becomes very cost intensive process. So it is better to use continuous operation with immobilized enzymes, and the enzyme should be immobilized and remain inside the reactor. But free enzymes can also be used, but we must care must be taken that the enzyme is very much cheap, very inexpensive, so that it does not incur a lot of cost. And but it will to some extent. So using immobilized enzymes is highly recommended when using continuous operation. And continuous operation is very attractive because it helps in automation of the plant. So it is very lucrative domain, and we will see further that the plug flow operation in continuous mode is the most suitable for for the case of enzymes. So let us discuss here about the continuous operation, because enzymes can be used in continuous mode if we are continuously supplying free enzymes, and if you are using small chunks of immobilized enzymes within the reactor, so that we can have a well mixed reactor and the enzyme also is not lost. So various strategies can be designed to operate the enzyme reactor in continuous mode in a well mixed continuously stirred tank reactor. So in continuous mode, we always continuously provide a feed stream, that is a continuous input stream, and we always continuously take output from our reactor. So we always have an active product stream, a continuous output stream. And substrate, in for case of enzyme, if it is free enzyme also must be continuously added to maintain steady state of the bicatalyst within the reactor, so that we can have always a constant rate of reaction within the reactor. And substrate is continuously added and product is continuously removed from a continuous stirred tank reactor. Ideally, the most preferred situation would be that substrate is completely utilized and product is and converted into product, so that there is no substrate in the output stream. But when we operate a reactor in steady state, then we will have a volumetric flow rate of F of the input stream, and to maintain a steady state, a constant volume and a constant homogeneous environment within the reactor, we must keep the output rate also similar to the input rate, so that the volume inside the reactor remains constant throughout, and thus providing us constant concentration situations. So the substrate which we provide input would get converted into product and will remain inside the reactor for a particular time until it comes out in the output stream. So under steady state conditions, when the conditions are homogeneous, the concentration within the reactor would be similar to the concentration in the output of the reactor. So if the concentration of substrate and product are S and P inside the reactor, then the concentration of product in the product stream would be P and S as the output in the output stream. So at steady state, the flow rates are maintained constant, so that the conditions inside it are constant. So this constant concentration condition is called as the chemostat condition of a continuous reactor. So the primary important thing in a continuous operation mode is for how much time our substrate remains inside the reactor. So for this, if we have the flow rate F, that is a volume of F is entering the reactor at this rate, within this time, like F liters per hour, 10 liters are entering the reactor per hour. So 10 liter would enter the reactor within a time frame of 1 hour. And if the total reaction volume is maintained to V, to a value of V, capital V. So how much time will it take to fill the reactor? For example, if the total volume is 100 liters and we are providing 10 liter per hour. So to fill the whole reactor at this flow rate, we will obviously take 10 hours. 10 liter per hour, and to fill 100 liters, it would take 10 hours. 1 hour, 10 liters. So to fill completely the reactor, we will take 10 hours. So this this is the time taken by the volume 10 liters to circulate within the reactor when we are operating it in continuous mode. So I gave the example that if we are this is 10 liters per hour and the total volume is 100 liters. So to fill it, we will take how much? 100 upon 10, that is 10 hour time. So if you even substituted the units, liter per hour, so hour will become here. So what was this? This was our total volume and this was our flow rate that we were using. So this time taken by this volume F to remain inside the vessel, inside the reactor, is called the holder time or the residence time of that volume. Although it is the time taken to fill the reactor. So at this flow rate, the first volume that enters in the first hour will remain inside the reactor and will move out of the reactor only after 10 hours. If we assume that whatever is entering goes ahead and the next liquid component entering, volume entering, shifts, pushes the earlier liquid volume towards the output side, and this way there is continuous movement of the liquid phases without any back mixing. So as imagining this situation, although this is not the case, but it is necessary to understand that when we provide input in the reactor, the substrate enters into the reactor and it is mixed inside the reactor, and we assume that it would take this much time to remain in the reactor. So it will have this much time, in other words, the substrate will have this much time to get reacted. So this is a very important criteria to understand the conversion, or to calculate the efficiency, or you can say this is the main design parameter of a continuous operation system. So if we represent it as tau. Now another important design criteria in continuously operated reactors is the dilution factor. Now to understand dilution, let me take a simple example. Suppose you had a solution, a 5 ml concentrated solution of certain substance. Okay, now you add a solvent, the solvent of the solution that was that is, this solution has a solute and a solvent. So the solvent of this solution, you add it further and you make up the volume to 10 ml. Now the total volume becomes 10 ml. So if I ask you how much the solution has been diluted to, what is the dilution of this solution? So to calculate dilution, you would say that dilution is the amount added, the volume added upon total volume. So here you added 5 ml and the total volume becomes 10. Okay, you had 5 ml, you added 5 ml, so the volume becomes 10. So the dilution of this solution is 0.5, isn't it? You have diluted the solution by 1/2. So this is what dilution is. So in case of continuous operated reactor, if you want to calculate dilution, so here since we are taking a volumetric flow rate, so we will have, consequently we will have a term called as dilution rate, and dilution rate will be volume added per unit time, that is F, upon total volume that is present inside the reactor and that is maintained inside the reactor. So we are maintaining a continuous volume of V by removing F from the reactor continuously. So output rate is made so that the volume of the reaction, the reaction volume, the reactor volume is kept constant. So the total volume remains V. So this is the dilution factor. So we can now see that this is our dilution factor is given by this. You can write here as the dilution factor of, in this case, the dilution factor of continuous operated reactor is given by F by V. So now comparing it with residence time. So therefore, residence time becomes residence time tau becomes 1 upon d. As this is v by f, this is f by v. So if we compare both of them, then tau is reciprocal of dilution rate. Residence time is reciprocal of dilution rate. So now carrying out mass balances for mass balance for this continuously operated reactor. Okay. Now the mass balance for this situation mass balances for substrate at steady state condition or at steady state operation, that is, there is no accumulation inside this reactor, there is a continuous movement and there is no accumulation of any component within the reactor, and this is, and the conditions are homogeneous, it is being operated as a chemostat first at steady state. So what we will have, rate of input of substrate. So this is the concentration term and this is the volume term. So rate of substrate mass input would be given by F into SI. This is the input rate. Now the output rate is minus FS. And the rate of reaction, rate of consumption of substrate is given by the Michaelis-Menten equation. And for free enzymes, now for free enzymes, like I said earlier, there must be a continuous supply of adequate amount of enzyme. Now this could be any amount that would be required to maintain the value of Vmax, and this should be very precisely controlled. We are assuming that it is very precisely controlled and Vmax is always constant throughout the operation. So rate of consumption would become Vmax S upon Km plus S for free enzymes. And again, since this is in the concentration terms, so this term will be multiplied by the total reactor volume. This would, and since it is a steady state, this would be equal to zero. So now if we assume that this is our equation this was our equation 2 and this would be our equation 3. So this would be our equation 4. Okay. Now dividing this equation by V throughout. Dividing equation 4 by the volume of the reactor V, we get F upon V. F upon V we know is the dilution rate. So we will write it down first. F by V into SI minus F by V into S minus V max S upon Km plus S equals to 0. Now this becomes, now this is a common term, F by V, F by V, and this by equation using equation 2, f by v can be written as using equation 2 we get, now both of them are common, d, so it will become si minus s, and this minus sign we can this reaction term can we can take it to the other side of the equation and become plus v max s upon Vm plus s. Now this is one of our design equations, and we can replace it by tau. If you replace it by tau, it will become 1 upon tau. So let us replace it by tau. So it would become, we can write down as r, 1 upon tau si minus s equals to v max s upon km plus s. This could also be written as tau equals to km plus s si minus s upon km plus s into si minus s upon v max s. Now this equation can be further solved and opened, and it could be written as tau is equal to Km Si plus, or we can do the multiplication this way, Km Si minus Kms plus SSI minus S square. Now we can either substitute it, we can write a common Vmax S, or we can substitute each and every part with Vmax S. Here it would be Vmax S upon Vmax S. So S would get cancelled at few places, and so we'll get a final equation. We'll get a final equation of the form Km Si upon Vmax S minus Km upon Vmax plus Si upon Vmax minus S upon Vmax. There are a lot of terms in this equation. We can either use this simple equation here itself, or we can use it as such, this equation. So what we can say is that if you want to calculate dilution rate, that at what dilution rate we must operate our reactor, we can use this equation and then calculate the value of tau. That would be much more simpler than evaluating it further. Now for case of immobilized enzymes, there would be just one more change. For immobilized systems, this final equation, now since we know that this is our final equation, so the final equation obtained here will be further simplified, but it's, you know, a useless a futile activity. So this is sufficient for us for evaluating the performance of the continuous operated enzyme reactors. So if we are using immobilized enzymes, then this equation for immobilized enzymes, this equation is transformed by using the effectiveness, total effectiveness factor. For immobilized enzymes, this equation can be just written for them by adding the effectiveness factor to the kinetics part. Now, effectiveness factor is a complex situation for immobilized enzymes because it could be only due to external diffusion restrictions, or it might also be due to external and internal diffusion restrictions. So depending upon the case, the value of neta can be substituted here, and we can easily find out the design dilution rate for our continuous mode of operation. So I hope you enjoyed the lecture and you found it very simple and easy to understand. And thank you. We'll meet in further lectures. Thank you.